Now, let's look at the countermeasures. The first is prevention. For example, we can limit the content of a computer to the untrusted outside world, meaning that it would not accept documents or programs or any active contents from other computers. And of course, this will impose major inconvenience to the computer user. The second approach is detection. This means that we use a monitor to watch out for telltale signs of malware infection. The third approach is removal, meaning that once we detect that there's malware infection, we will remove the malware and perhaps we should also patch the system. Given that prevention severely hampers productivity, detection is really the main countermeasure that we can use. And there are four generations of antivirus software or malware detection software. The first is malware scanners. These scanners used signatures or patterns of known viruses to scan program files to find matches. And if there's a match, that means that this program file has been infected by a known virus. What are the examples of signatures of viruses? A signature of a virus is typically the unique sequence of instructions of the virus code or the unique infection marker that the virus would use. These simple scanners are not effective against polymorphic viruses. And the reason is that for polymorphic virus, each instance is encrypted with a randomly generated key such that there's no unique signature across all instances of the same virus. The second is the heuristic scanners. They are based on possible effects of infection. For example, if a program file has been infected with the virus code, the checksum of the original file would have changed because new contents has been added to the file. However, this approach can be defeated if the malware deliberately makes sure that the checksum after infection remains the same. For example, the malware can include some additional bytes at the end of the file to make sure that the checksum remains the same as the file before its infection. The third is activity traps. These detectors look for particular kind of activities that malware would typically perform on a system, such as modifying the Windows registry file or reading the password file and sending it to the internet and so on. These detectors are based on our knowledge of malware activities. Therefore, these detectors are not effective against malware that performs new kinds of malicious activities. The fourth is the so-called full feature analysis, which is the state of the art. It typically involves multiple approaches. For example, it typically includes host-based monitoring. That in turn includes activity traps and scanners. It also includes network-based monitors that analyze traffic to the internet. For example, if there's a traffic that contains password file to an internet server, that can be a telltale sign that a malware has infected an end host and is attempting to steal the password file. Similarly, if there's a connection to a website that's well known for malware download, that's also a telltale sign that the end host has been infected and the malware on that host is attempting to download an update. And it can also include a sandboxing-based analysis approach. A sandbox is typically used to run a piece of executable, for example, an attachment from an email, to see whether this executable would exhibit any malicious activities. By executing this executable in a sandbox, we can make sure that there's no permanent damage to our system and network. And we can observe the behaviors of the executable from outside the sandbox so that we can be certain whether this executable is a malware or not.